In few minutes, when I read out his profile, you will understand the importance and the significance of this person, the contributions that he has made to the field of medicine, especially. Ajay Kumar. And how is he here? Again, one single cause. The real hero amongst us is our own founder president, Mr. Tulay Moideen. And that's how he is here today. As one of the heroes of health personalities, would be a very difficult task. Cancer Care Center with the latest technology and the best of expertise in India. 25 cancer care centers across India with dedicated cancer centers in Tier 2. The pioneers in introducing the whole body robotic brain, HDPED, pre-test and MRI, SCIDA, digital mammogram. Dr. Ajay Kumar, for 2 consecutive years, and his dream was fulfilled. He was also awarded the Erstwhile Young Entrepreneur. It's my proud privilege to be seeing you here at the university today once again. Where is he? He said he's trekking in Himalayas. I don't know if he's still continuing that. Gentlemen, put your hands together to welcome Dr. Ajay Kumar.
Thanks for inviting me here again to be with you all more than before. More importantly, great experience for me to be here after 10 years and see the phenomenal development which has happened under the leadership of your president and all the faculty. It was a great privilege for me to have met all the faculty and the wonderful presentation which happened showing how, you know, under the leadership the Dubai Group has grown and how they are contributing to the healthcare, not only this part of the world, but globally. Once again, my congratulations and all that to Mr. Moideen and all the faculty who have contributed to this. And also, I want to thank Ravi for the wonderful introduction. Ravi, thank you very much. Be nice. And I always remember our experience in Afghanistan, how we landed in the middle of gunshots. I remember the drive through the airport. The whole airport was full of bullets and no planes. All the planes were all grounded because of bullets. And I remember the international plane where we stayed after the world was bombed. So it was a wonderful experience. Having said that, today I will not throw you too many slides. Ravi already warned me not to become too technical, but to share with you the why I became a doctor. You know, we all have a vision and a dream. When we want to be doctors, you become doctors for various reasons. A scenario is, one is, it's a prestigious thing to be a doctor. The society recognizes you. You feel good, the feel good factor, you know, being a doctor. Then you have, you want to contribute something to the society. And you say, you know, let me do something, I want to serve the people, which is natural idealism. Then, you know, you think you can get a good bride and you get a dowry, good dowry in the Indian system. You're well priced, high priced. So that is the reason. Then the parents push you. My doctor should become a doctor, or the daughter, because they find a good grind. So there are a lot of reasons. Other is, of course, people think it's a very profitable profession. It's a very safe, profitable, don't have to worry about recession, depression, the longest patients for me. So various reasons we become doctors. So what I would like to do is to share, to some extent, my own story. And why I chose oncology more important. Becoming a doctor, you know, was mainly because my brother was a doctor. And he was in medical school. And one day my father said, you know, he's in medical school. Somehow my brother was brilliant. He was a brilliant guy. He's a urologist in the US. And somehow, you know, when the first son is brilliant, always somehow you're under the radar. People don't recognize you that much, however good you are. In a way, it's very positive. So I was bubbling along happily, you know, without being under too much pressure. But when I scored very good marks in my 10th grade, suddenly my family woke up. You know, this guy may be also good. There's something in him. So suddenly they started putting a lot of pressure on you, saying, you've got to get into medicine. At that time, in the late 60s, it was not easy to get into medicine. It was all competitive exam. And unfortunately, I got into one of the major medical schools, St. John's Medical College, which is highly recognized. And to make it short, the 5 years went by very quickly. At the end of it, you know, in the early 70s in India, when you look at it, it was very bureaucratic. Everything was government controlled, private enterprise was not there, and the infrastructure facilities were very few. But opportunity to go abroad was plenty. You know, your so-called green card would come home. You have to pass your exam and they would welcome you. So my brother went and I was trying to see what I can do in India. Honestly, I was going to work in some rural program. But suddenly I got good marks in my, at that time it was called ECFMG. Yeah, I got good marks and long behold I had the green card. So I said, you know, for a few years I'll go and try it out. But I always wanted to be a cardiologist. In all my clinical exam I stood very good in cardiology. I was a leader in cardiology in terms of, as a medical student, recognizing the murmurs and doing the workup, what is the cardiac disease. So my interest was cardiology. But what changed me was my first year in Virginia, when I got into this very prestigious university in Virginia. I was making rounds one day, and I saw people with a lot of pain and suffering in various parts of the hospital, in the fourth floor, towards the end rooms. They were not in the middle. And they were in pain, pain was not addressed properly. So when I started seeing these patients, it just struck me, you know, why are we here as doctors? Why do we become doctors? You know, when you look at the various oaths we take, Hippocratic Oath, all that, you know, pain and suffering is the key. How to alleviate pain and suffering? We know none of us are immortals, you know, when we talk about terminal disease and living. You know, we all have to realize in a way we are all terminal once you are born. We don't say somebody is 90 years old terminal, somebody who is 30 years old. So using these terminologies, calling cancer patients as victims, calling them as palliative care. I remember one doctor writing on the chart, this poor cancer victim. So all that had a significant effect on me to think in terms of realignment. So why not take up this field, which is a challenge, rather than take up something cardiology, which is more fashionable to do, cardiologist. Take something that nobody wants to do and challenge it and see how you can change the dynamics of oncology. So some of you, all of you are budding doctors. So naturally, you will be seeing oncology patients. So what I am not here to preach. I want to really give you thought process for you to sit back, reflect, and decide at some point what you want to be. Hopefully, I will help you in this process. So when I looked at it, I said, okay, I'll really take up oncology. So I went to my professor there and said, you know what, I want to do oncology. So they accommodated me there and put me in the field of oncology, radiation oncology. But it was only part of oncology when you look at radiation. So after going through the radiation oncology, I felt totally incomplete after 1 year of residency. So I went to, I remember talking to this professor. He was an Egyptian, Dr. Elmadi. He was having a cup of coffee. I said, "Don't you, Dr. Elmadi, you know, I feel I'm not a complete oncologist. I'm not becoming. I really need to go and train much better than what you're offering here." He was surprised and shocked. he took his coffee inside his room and said, who knows, apply to MD Anderson, you will get it. MD Anderson was the most difficult place to get at that time. There was a 3-year waiting period. So I promptly applied, and I got a reply back saying that they don't have any opening. This was in 1975. They said, don't have a claim till 1977, but I can go and interview, be interviewed. So I went, took one of those Greyhound buses and traveled all the way from Virginia to Houston. And when I went there, after 3 days of interview, whatever it is, you know, whatever I did, I don't know, they offered me a post right away. They were impressed, I suppose. So the post was offered at a very high level as a fellow too. And immediately I joined. My professor at Virginia was very unhappy. So after joining and going through the residency as MD Anderson, I just want to take a minute here and explain about how, you know, there are times in your life where the changes take place. There are moments in your life where you feel has had an impact on your future. So MD Anderson was an impact on my future. When I went there, the amazing thing, you know, if you have opportunity, you should visit the place or Sloan Kettering in New York. It is a mecca of oncology care where people are treated as human beings, not as cancer victims. If people came from all over the world, Latin America, from Asia to European countries, in the last stages, so-called, when doctors there in those countries told that nothing can be done, they came there with hope. What was the driving force for them is hope. You know, we all live for hope, obviously. You know, hope is an important factor. Hope is a powerful element. So people came with hope. The amazing thing is people came even though they knew they may not live, subjecting their bodies for trials, clinical trials, experiments. Why? You know, when I interviewed people, I remember interviewing a patient that I was taking care of, a young guy from Florida with leukemia. He said, you know, doctor, whatever they can learn from me will help the future generation. This is the attitude they had. Even though they knew they will not live for 6 to 9 months. What a great philosophy of life when you look at it. You know, I call it onco philosophy. When you see oncology patients, we learn a lot about life. When people are about to die, I'll give you a few more inspiring stories later on. When we know they're about to die, and still they're consoling the doctor and telling, you know, I'm willing to be part of this trial so that others can learn from it. So that talks about our immortality factor. Are we really? These are the immortals, really. Because we remember them every day when we do other patients' care. So having had that experience for a year, and then I took on to do what I call as developmental therapeutics there. I was one of the few fellows to take up a highly experimental therapy program called developmental therapeutics, where, for some of you may not know, when cancer treatment comes to daily use, it goes through phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and then phase 4. Phase 1 is the highly experimental, where it is first time being tried on human beings. Never tried, we don't know what the dosing is, so we give it as a trial. Whatever side effects happens, we document, and based on that, we decide whether this drug should be used or not. So I had patients suffering with a lot of side effects. I remember a football player in the US, you know, muscular, having so many side effects and having fungal infection because of the drug, eventually dying. So this had a serious psychological effect on us, obviously, you know. Very difficult to sleep at night when you go through this program. So having experienced this, I worked in specialized in lung field. I was interested in lung at that time. One day, as I was completing my residency fellowship program, the director of MD Anderson called me because I was trained in two specialties, radiation oncology and medical oncology. At that time, I believe in Saudi Arabia, King Faisal Hospital under which MD Anderson was opening a center, a big cancer center. So he called me and said, can you take care of this because you're trained in two fields. I told him, Dr. Hickey, my eventual goal is to go back to India. If I leave US, I go back to India. I do a lot of things here and there. I don't think I will go to Saudi Arabia. Let me focus here and do. So he was not happy, but eventually I I decided to go on my own practice near Chicago. And as I practiced there, you know, I was planning on setting up a center in India, as Ravi said, in 19. I traveled back and forth from US, spent several months in India. I had a partnership model, I developed a group practice in US. And the reason is to study the what was happening in India, what was happening in US. Here I would like to even state what made me really come back to India and what inspired me. One of the things is I had a patient in US by named Phyllis, who was about 44 years old. This was in the early 80s. When I first saw her, she was one of my first patients in US, July 15th, 1979. And she had metastatic cancer, those of you know, breast cancer which has spread to bone. And when I went to see her, the doctors had kept her saying, this doctor, Harsha doctor is coming from Houston, joining us, wait for him to come and see you, because you are terminal, let him come. So I went and started talking to her and telling her how the treatment will work, how she can go back to work. She worked in a Champion plug factory. And as I started talking to her, her eyes started brightening and she had life come back to her. I said, you mean to say I'm not terminal? She said, you're not terminal, you're going to live for next 5 to 10 years of treatment. Breast cancer with mets to bone is not terminal, definitely we can control. So next, all she asked me was, Dr. AJ used to call me, Dr. AJ, I have this vision, she was 48 at the time, of going to ski in Colorado, I want to bicycle in UK, I have all these things I wanted to do after 62. See that you can put all these things together for me to do all this in the next few years I have. So we created a plan for her, for Phyllis. I called it the Phyllis plan for her. I worked with her where she got chemotherapy for 6 years, but still she went on all her rides, did her skiing, went with her family, trekking and bicycling in Ireland. So at the end of, to make it short, in 1986-87, I was one of my trips to India. I got a, her disease had come back in lung after 8 years. And then when I went and shot, I told her I'd come back from India and talk her on some experimental drug. But I got a call the day I went back to US, Chicago, and then saying that Phyllis is very sick. So I went and saw her at her home on a Sunday. She was sitting in one corner, literally coughing. I said, Phyllis, tomorrow, let us see what we can do. She said, no. I just wanted to thank you for the 8 years I accomplished everything I wanted to do. I have completed everything at my goals, and that night she died. That very night she died. It's a great learning curve for us as doctors when you look at it. You know, it is not really living 100 years or 90 years. It is what is your accomplishment? Did you accomplish things you wanted to do? I have similarly, you know, fast forward to you now, I had a patient who was a father got me his son, and along with his grandson, for son had a big tumor in the abdomen. He said, Doctor, I've been to all over centers in India. This tumor is growing at a minimum. I just want him to leave for a year to see his grandson graduate from his high school or something. So we put lot of, he's not, he didn't ask for more. So we put four things together, infused chemotherapy to the tumor, blocked all the blood supply, what we call as chemo embolization, and did a very advanced therapy this. And got his pain, get rid of, and last thing I know, he's still alive, and I think his son has graduated from what I know. So he accomplished, goal accomplished, mission accomplished, you know. I think that is how we have to look at. What do these people come for as doctors? We cannot cure everybody, we are not gods. But can we accomplish what have they come for? Pain, suffering, and something in life, their son's marriage, or the daughter's marriage. This is how, as a doctor, we also become to some extent social reformers. We get into this area. And that should be our mission. And another patient I remember, again, US, who had a blood pressure of, away after 6-7 years, blood pressure was nearly 50 by 0. And then as I was talking to her, I started crying. Because naturally you get attached to the patient and you shouldn't leave. She said, Dr. AJ, you know, don't cry. Here she is about to die, consoling the doctor. You know, what is the message we get from her? There are things we can never forget. So coming back to the Indian scenario, as I traveled in the late 80s and saw, what really made a huge difference for me was two instances. Two instances. One was a Madhya Pradesh, there was a patient, I was visiting the center at about 10:30, 11. There was a small little girl who was about 24 months with a sarcoma in the abdomen, big tumor in the abdomen. And the mother was fanning the baby. I said, what is happening? You know, how long have you been waiting? Mother said, waiting from morning 11 o'clock. And for treatment with the cobalt unit, which is a broken down unit, not able to give. And again, clearly telling me there's a great need to establish new centers. Similarly, a Mother Teresa patient who was brought one day to our center in Mysore, which is a not-for-profit center, with bleeding from cervix cancer. 2 weeks later, we took her on as a free case. 2 weeks later, I was leaving the US. Same lady was there waving at me. I asked her, is this the same person with a happy smile on her face? And again, you know, it tells you, you know, whatever it is, Medicare, Medicaid, you know, all the things in US, you know, writing protocols, trying to see how much I get reimbursed, what is the money I get, forget all that, I can't get back to India. So those are the differential which made me come back to India. And what we have accomplished in the last 7 years is change a paradigm shift in the cancer care. And I will just, I think, try to run through a few things showing what a gigantic problem we have in India. And it is a global problem. India has a population of 1.2 billion with great unmet demand. Few centers all concentrated in the big cities with good doctors. But how, with an entrepreneurial spirit, the Indian doctor, entrepreneur, you can create a model whereby you can achieve your goal for treatment at all, and at the end I'll show you some reports from Harvard Business School showing how our center HCG has the same outcome of the results of breast cancer as some of the best centers in US with 1/10 the cost. So very good way we have been able to accomplish, and the Harvard study has shown clearly. So this is showing the healthcare scenario in India where we spend very little of the money, and I will just rush through this showing that compared to US and all, we spend only a fraction of the money for healthcare in India. Then US spends 19% of their gross domestic product, whereas we spend 4%. In that, 3.5% is from private enterprise. So we spend only $40 overall compared to huge amounts spent like abroad and other advanced countries. So the drivers in India, the issue we face is rising population, which is going to have a huge impact on the healthcare, and particularly when people get old. Young population at some point are going to get old. How are we going to take care of this? It's a huge task for us. And again, showing here the incidence of cancer in India. India and China are going to be the leaders in cancer, unfortunately, whether we like or not, because of the sheer population, habits, smoking. You know, we all know young people smoking is a very common thing. The damage that does to the active smoker and passive smoker is unimaginable. So if you all know somebody who smokes, or you all smoke, it's time you all quit and encourage others not to smoke. And this is a very important thing, which is a huge impact on not only cancer, but also cardiac disease and other lung diseases, which are very common in smokers, and it's going to increase. So again, as for budding doctors, I want to say, the fear is our first enemy. When we talk about cancer, the fear of cancer, and sometimes our politicians, people in public spaces say, when they talk about corruption or bureaucracy, this is cancer of the society. So the cancer patients even gets worse, the more fear. Cancer means dreadful. So we have to stop using such words and use right terminology at the right time. And saying that your stage 4 disease, as you proceed to become doctors, my request is please refrain from using terminal word, palliative care, or stage 4, or the worst thing a doctor can do is for the patient, the family, is to give a timeline. You have 6 months to live, you have a year to live. Because I know in our own practice we come across patients who have lived not only for months, for years. I remember Mr. Heaven Hill who came to me in 1980. He said, "Doctor, I have this lump under my arm in the US." I said, "How long have you had the lump?" When you look at his history, 1974, his tumor, they did a lung surgery saying that he had advanced lung cancer. So Dr. Smith told him, "You have one summer, Mr. Evan Hill, so have a good summer, nothing can be done." He said, "Every summer I was waiting for my last summer." Like 6 summers he has waited. So like that, we all have instances where we should be careful about how we use this terminology, which causes significant problem on the patients. Even though they deserve treatment, they run away from treatment because we use the terminologies such as palliative, stage 4 and others. So fear is our worst enemy. If one disease is there, it's the fear disease more than cancer we should get rid of. And the media, the fuel with the cancer. So we need to create role models or done well, how these people can talk, how today diseases such as breast cancer, or people can live with it for not just 5-10 years, but 68% of cancer patients die of other disease, not of cancer, even though they have cancer. So it's a huge paradigm shift which has taken place in this disease now. So let us remember, hope was never taken. Hope is an important thing for patient and the family, as long as you are truthful to them. Important to be truthful, explain to them what the situation is, never tell things which are not true. At the same time, make them part of your decision making, them and the family. So again in India, the problem we face, which we may not face here, is we are considered a poor country. So people, one of the paradigm shift what we did in HCG was, poor or rich doesn't matter, they all deserve the same thing. We can't say this guy is poor, let us treat inferior. But cancer knows poor, doesn't know poor or rich. So how do you create a model where we bring state-of-the-art therapy and treat all the people? That is what we did. We brought in linear accelerators, phased out cohorts, and improved the care, whereby our outcome has improved because of this. So clearly showing not only patients live longer, they have good quality of life, at the same time in the long run actually the cost is less because they are living a normal life, they are not repeatedly going to the hospitals. So this is the model of the thing where we call it a big paradigm shift has happened. So this is showing that how many centers we have been able to do in a short period of time. In the last 6-7 years, we have put up 27 centers and we see nearly 50,000 patients of cancer every year. And as far as people who come and all that, we know repeat patients who come follow up, nearly close to 500,000 patients. In all our centers, we are expanding to different parts of the country, in East Africa, where there is another great unmet demand. So our goal is to be in areas where people come and ask me, then why not put up a center in Europe or America, where I was, I say, not where there is no need. I feel there is a tremendous need in countries such as Africa, emerging economies. That is where we should focus on and make a change in oncology and cancer care approach. As a doctor, that is what I feel. And as a doctor, I feel I should be dedicated to this and see that it becomes a sustainable model. So we use the hub and spoke model, create a main hub, like in Bangalore is a main hub, and spokes around it so the patients can facilitate. Technology is used to the hilt, like telemedicine, teleradiology. We pioneer telephysics, where patients sitting in a distant small town, then planning can be done in Bangalore. So this is how technology has been used. So this is showing the, I'll just quickly move on, showing how we have grown in the last few years. From one of the things for the future doctors, I want to say one take home message, whether it is cancer or cardiology or any disease, a lot of emphasis has to be given for proper staging and proper diagnosis. Therapy is pretty much there, the protocols are there, everything is there. For you as students, the focus should be on proper diagnosis. And cancer is very true. We have advanced therapies like molecular imaging, we have molecular diagnostics, genomics, where today we can say, for you it's a great opportunity to go into research on these areas, where you can look at a patient through the blood test sampling or tissue sampling, you can tell not only how long the patient may going to live, what may be the treatment, what is the particular drug which is going to help them based on genomics, based on biomarkers. We can decide, for example, colon cancer, I'll give you one example, there's a KRAS in breast cancer, Herceptin. Based on this, is this patient going to respond to this therapy? If it responds, how well they're going to do and how will be their outcome? So huge opportunity for youngsters to take up this exciting field of genomics as well as molecular imaging, where there is a lot of research and development going on. One of the other areas in which research is going on is in the area of what we call as biologistic, where we actually do xenografting. For example, you take a tissue, a malignant tissue from a patient, and you put it into mice. And then you grow that tissue in the mice, and then you subject the mice to chemotherapy before you give the patient. If that works in the mice, you give it to the patient. So each patient, you know, let us say Mrs. Johnson has her own pet, Johnson pet. So she'll be, the pet will be with her, and based on the response of the pet, we decide what should be the right thing. So this is how we are advancing in xenografting to see huge personalized medicine coming up. So apart from that, in some areas we have also gone into some of the multi-speciality for various reasons. We are working on doing some similar models in other areas like infertility as well as cardiology. So this is the first Harvard's Business School study. When they came and studied us, what they liked about us is the focus factory model, what we have. Where they said, you know, here is an institution in a short time which has done such a good work. Let us find out how they have done it. So they came and worked for about 6 months, reviewed all of our records, looked at me, interviewed our doctors, patients, and they came up and said, this model works very well when you're focused in a particular specialty rather than doing multi-speciality and saying oncology is part of it. And one of the things they liked about is, I call it 11 o'clock, 11 a.m., 11 p.m. as the doctors, you know, and as administrators, we always wonder how I can treat everybody. So in our center, 11 o'clock in the morning, we may have a patient who comes, paying patient, where there is a coffee given to them, and there is a person who welcomes them, takes them to the treatment room, radiation, delivers, and goes home. Whereas at 11 in the night, a patient may come, he may not get coffee, he may not have a receipt, but they get the same treatment and they subsidize the fee care. So 11 a.m., 11 p.m., all I need to do is to turn on the electricity, possibly, you know, have a technologist and a doctor there. But without much cost, I can deliver this kind of treatment. So this is what they liked about the model, where treatment to all affordable patients at an affordable cost, even if they can't afford, we create personalized economic model to see that they get this kind of therapy. So accessibility, availability, affordability. Why should a patient travel from Northeast India to West part of India to Mumbai get treatment? Why not in the hometown? bring in high technology there. And this is how, you know, we can make sure patients get the optimal care near their home. So redefining cancer care has been our goal. And one of the areas, without getting into too technical, I just want to say, you also have to modify your treatment based on ethnics. We cannot say I'm going to treat all the patients as I treated Caucasians. You know, all the research development has happened in the Caucasians. Unfortunately, in India, we are followers. For various reasons, we have not been able to do our own research, development. That is an area of great interest. We are doing it. I'll show you that in the last slide. So some of the things we have done is like the weekly therapy, whereby, like this. Normally, the medicine is given every 3 weeks. Why not give it weekly? And we get the same results. Why not we reduce the dose? And organ preservation, you know, for example, I would like to say for you, for future doctors, never let any of your patients sacrifice their breast, sacrifice their larynx, sacrifice their limb. There is no need to give up these organs in oncology. It is considered actually malpractice if somebody gets mastectomy now. So let us proceed there. The results are equally good, if not better. So this is how we can change the dynamics of cancer care and make them normal individuals who be accepted in the society. So that is the key, to make them normal individuals. So, so the right mix is important. You need, obviously, you know, specialists. You need technology, manpower, knowledge. And then with the right mix, you can achieve your goals. And care to all. Obviously, you know, you want to make sure everybody is taken care of. And this is using this kind of model, financing model, how you raise funds. That is an area where we have also gained expertise to innovations to make sure high technology can be brought. Today, India is a leader in oncology. We have CyberKnife to high-end imaging techniques, and we are in the process of bringing proton therapy. So with this, we feel like we've been able to achieve this through innovations. So standard quality care, affordable places, and meeting the globally accepted standards for outcome, which is very important. When a patient comes to you as a doctor, why does the patient come to you as a doctor? They want you to give the right treatment. Am I right? Anybody wants to dispute that? Okay? Of course, you're going to charge the patient, but they come to you because they want the right treatment. They're trusting you, am I right? So when you do the right treatment, how do you know you're doing the right treatment? By word of mouth? Can anybody answer, how do you know, or do you know the right treatment is done?
By diagnosis.
No, diagnosis is done. You're given a treatment. How do you know it's the right treatment? How? Based on how the patient does, right?
How the patient does.
So, based on that, particularly in oncology, you have to see how the patient does for long time. Whether your treatment has worked as good as others, what is the protocols, and has it stacked up against it. So that is how you measure an individual doctor, your capabilities, as well as the institution. So, and this is again showing the, I don't think I need to do this, I will skip this one. So I'll now go on to all the technology which is there. In, for example, in our center, we use these tablets for patients. So they measure the doctor outcome using these tablets. They say, is the doctor was on time? Is the doctor explained to me properly? So we give a rating system. 5 is the best rating, and based on that, where do the doctor stand, where do the nurses stand, where do the housekeeping stand, all of these are measured by the patient and analyzed. At the same time, we have these apps for breast cancer patients, where going through the apps, you know, for example, you have some woman who is working in technology or somewhere, teacher, wants to know about the breast cancer, how to self-examine these apps, they can go through these apps and find out what are the things to do. So it is made it very accessible for them. This is the main technology that anybody said. No, I'll still move on to the new molecules which we have developed. This may be recent to high end, so I'm not going into this too much. But just to show that today, this is an area of brain tumor. If somebody comes with a lesion in the brain, pre-treatment, post-treatment, using this new technique, Ketioni, which we have developed locally there in India. We are one of the world leaders for this Ketioni, which is very half-life. You have to have your own, like a cyclotron, which is a mini nuclear power plant. We have our own. We can distinguish between dead tissue and live tissue. And thereby we can hit the right place and not treat the necessarily the brain. So the whole treatment is not to do treatment unnecessary areas. Normal tissue to be left alone, treat only the tumor, so side effects will be less, outcome will be better. So this is all the molecular diagnostic test to complicated looks. Here the genomics seal what we have. All these things just to, okay. So this is again showing the PET scan, how you can, those of you are not seeing, the area of tumor shows up. So you know exactly what area to treat. So some of you hopefully will take up, radiology is one of the major fields. I would encourage all of you to consider taking radiology. It's a very upcoming field, molecular imaging, very exciting field for doctors to take up and do a lot of research apart from the, you know, including pathology also. These are the two fields some of you should consider. It may be not clinical, but very, very exciting field. This is the CyberBrain, which is the robotic treatment. What it does is it has a robotic, sorry, I'll just show this for a minute. Now, it has a robotic arm and this is a linear accelerator which is compressed, a huge linear accelerator is compressed. Using the robot, it can actually use artificial intelligence and it can say where exactly the tumor is. Suppose I mark red as the tumor, it will hit only red. The robot will seek and destroy. It will not destroy any normal tissue, but will seek only the red and destroy it. At different angles. It is a fun thing to watch when people is getting treatment, how it seeks.
Ahmad Jali, I am farming second year. I want to ask you, according to your experience, it's very important in the oncology or no, we should concentrate about the drugs and chemotherapy first, then the emotional part will come at last.
Your question is concerned with integrated psycho-oncology. In my experience, attitude is very important. Like if I have a patient who is positive and the family is supportive, they normally do if the family is not supportive. You know, if the patients start thinking, why me, why I got cancer, poor me, you know, and then they start crying and they're emotionally disturbed, they don't get enough support, chances of them doing well, a particular family also feels like a burden, that he or she is a burden to them, they have to leave work, come. Naturally, the patient is not going to do well. In all my documentations I have done, people with that attitude, they are not willing to change, they will not do well. They will have more pain, symptoms and all that. Various trials have been done, they are clearly showing they express these symptoms because of their psychological issues. And once you overcome that, they will become better in terms of even quality of life. So positive attitude, one of the things we as doctors and the activities, there are resource people, they come and talk about their experience.
The founder, president and chairman board of governance of the Garg Medical University to kindly come on stage, and I would request Dr. Ajay Kumar to join them on stage.